Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And by way of introduction of our feature subject tonight, there's this.
Hello world, in a song that we're singing. Come on, get happy. A whole lot of loving is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy. We are a dream, we go travel together. We spread a little love.
Girls are following me around. They're ruining my whole life.
Aren't you exaggerating just a little?
You think I'm exaggerating? You should have seen what happened to me today while I was registering for classes.
Well, for those of you who didn't know it, that was the Partridge Family and their huge star, David Cassidy, who died recently at the age of 67. The show started in 1970 and went to 1974, and for that time, David Cassidy was arguably the biggest star in the world, at least among girls roughly ages 9 to 15. His fan club at the time was reported to be bigger than that of Elvis and the Beatles combined. He was good-looking, he could act, and he could sing. The show was based on the musical group The Cowsills. They couldn't act at all. And David Cassidy became the star and the lead, which is saying something considering that his co-star was his stepmother, Shirley Jones, who, well, let's see, she was the star of The Music Man, she was the star of Oklahoma, and she won an Academy Award for Elmer Gantry with Burt Lancaster. But she willingly took second billing to David Cassidy, which says a lot about both of them.
That tryout show, surprisingly, had no music, no singing.
No, the very first show, you know, I'm not sure that they knew how they were going to get the show started, but we were all musical people. And when they told me that David Cassidy was going to play my son on the show, and we were sort of going to be a musical family, you know, we would put the band together and everything, I was so excited because I knew David was such a wonderful singer, and I didn't know the world knew about it. Well, they certainly got to know about it because, as you well know, he became the teen idol of America and was just about the biggest star around for a long, long time.
It wasn't a great show, but they were able to market it around David Cassidy's appeal and his ability to sell records, which was for a while prodigious. And for a while they'd put him on magazine covers and lunch boxes and all sorts of tchotchkes. But to a certain extent, that was his downfall. And before we play a couple of his records, let's talk about that. I mentioned that Shirley Jones was his stepmother. His real mother was an actress named Evelyn Ward. He lived with her, but he idolized his father, Jack Cassidy, who divorced her to marry Shirley Jones. And Jack Cassidy was a handsome, talented actor who had a terrible alcohol problem and some mental problems. He did a lot of television shows in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. He was up for the role of Ted Baxter in the Mary Tyler Moore Show, which he turned down. He would have been great at it. He was great as a magician killer in Columbo. And one of the ironies of David Cassidy's life is that when he hit it big, Jack Cassidy was jealous of his success, but nevertheless advised him, don't fall for all this rock star stuff, remain an actor and practice your craft. I didn't do it and I should have. Jack Cassidy ultimately died of alcoholism in a tragic fire, and David Cassidy didn't listen to his father and sort of met the same fate. To a certain extent, a victim of his rock star status, which ultimately disappeared and left him without a real acting career. But he made some great records. They were bubblegum, but they were top-grade bubblegum. They were backed by the Wrecking Crew and top-grade writers like Wes Farrell, who wrote the theme song. Here's his best record. And you know what? I don't care what the music snobs and the critics at the Washington Post say. This was good music. This is I Think I Love You. The harpsichord is being played by the multi-talented Larry Nectel of the Wrecking Crew.
You really don't have to worry. I only want to make you happy. And if you say, hey, go away, I will. But I think better still, I'd better stay around and love you. Do you think I have a case? Let me ask you to your face. Do you think you love me? I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I love you. I think I love you.
That one's great, and this one's almost as good. I woke up in love this morning, which Spike Lee used in his movie Crooklyn.
Last night, I turned off the lights, lay down and thought about you. I thought about the way that it could be at 2 o'clock, wondering what I'm doing here alone without you. So I close my eyes and dream you're here to me. I woke up in love this morning, went to sleep with you.
be rolling around in your head for a while, I guarantee. This is one that Jerry Goffin wrote the lyrics to way past his Carole King days. If you go back and listen to our podcast on him, you can tell there's a little bit of Jerry in the lyrics here.
I'll meet you halfway. That's better than no way. There must be some way to get together.
He did a remake of Cherish by The Association. I have to tell you, I'm not crazy about it, but it was very popular.
Cherish is the word I use to describe. You don't know how many times I wish that I had told you. You don't know how many times I wish that I could hold you. You don't know how many times I wish that I could fall in love with someone. Cherish me as much as I cherish you.
Here's one that they sang on the show that's not a great song, but I included it because he sang it with Shirley Jones. Remember, one of the most talented stars of two of the greatest musicals of the 20th century, and she's singing backup.
Singing it out to the people, singing it out to them all, singing my song and they'll sing it along. All of my problems are oh so small. All of my problems are so small. I said it on, did it on.
Not sure a lot of Broadway stars would have done that. I'm going to close with one last song that's also a great song. It's in the league with I Woke Up This Morning and I Think I Love You, and I'm playing it for a reason, which I'll tell you afterward.
I go downtown and roam all around, but every street I walk, I find another dead end. I'm on my own, but I'm so all alone. I need somebody so I won't have to pretend.
Doesn't somebody want to be
like his father, David Cassidy died a premature death brought on by alcoholism. And in that last song, he has a speaking part in the middle. I'm going to play something that nobody else will play on any other show. A little bit of that speaking part in the middle by a full-throated young David Cassidy, and then an interview he did near the end of his life. You can hear the change in his voice, but the words are almost the same. And for my money, a pretty eerie coincidence.
You know, I'm no different from anybody else. I start each day and I end each night. But it gets really lonely when you're by yourself. Now, where is love? And who is love? I gotta know.
That was the young, full-throated pop idol. This is real life not too long before his death.
And that's when I was drinking, I lost. I just became lonely, isolated. I would isolate. I would go and buy a bottle of booze and come back and go upstairs in my room, close the door, and stay there and drink alone. That's a sad, dark place to be.
Well, we're going to close tonight with George Avakian, who died recently at the age of 98. And if David Cassidy was about music of the moment, George Avakian was about music over time. He was one of the most important figures in American music in the 20th century because of his interest in jazz. He didn't play jazz, but he collected it, he wrote about it, and he recorded it. He was a college student at Yale in 1938 when most of the jazz devotees in America were part of a small society and it was not a mainstream thing. He wrote to Decca Records and told them, hey, you've got to get into jazz. And he offered his services and Decca Records took him up on it. In the next 20 years, here are a couple of the things he did. He produced the first jazz album in 1940, Chicago Jazz for Decca. He wrote the first jazz album liner notes. He produced the first 10-inch LP at Columbia, The Voice of Frank Sinatra, in 1948. He produced the first 12-inch jazz LP in 1950, Benny Goodman at Carnegie Hall, which also happened to be the first double LP set. He signed Miles Davis in 1955 and helped make the trumpeters jazz's first modern superstar. He revived the careers of Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington, which we'll talk about in a little while, and he also helped found Warner Brother Records. He did most of his best work in the 1950s at Columbia Records, where he also signed an unknown 19-year-old named Johnny Mathis. When he moved to Warner Brothers in the late 50s to help start Warner Brother Records, the company was failing for a couple years, and they were about to give up record sales, if you can imagine it, when he had two masterstrokes. One was to produce a comedy album. Comedy albums were becoming big in the late 50s and early 60s that we talked about when we did the Shelley Berman podcast. And the comedy album that he produced was The Button-Down Mind of Bob Newhart.
As I said, there was a thing on the paper tonight about documentaries. And I've had an idea for a long time for what I think is a wonderful documentary, which has everything. For instance, you go to work, you come home at night, and you never really think about it. It's mechanical, it's routine. But there are a group of men who every day, when they go to work, never know if that night they'll return, because they face death in 100 different ways. And I'm talking about America's driving instructors.
That album was a million seller, and not only made Bob Newhart's career, but it paved the way for all the memorable comedy albums of the 1960s and 70s. Avakian's other master stroke at Warner was when the Everly Brothers left Cadence Records, he signed them to rock and roll's first million-dollar contract in 1960. And that paid off big time with their first hit at Warner, which was one of the biggest songs of 1960. Don't want your love. Between that record and Bob Newhart's comedy album, George Avakian helped save Warner Brother Records. Didn't do that well for the Everly Brothers. They had a couple of big hits at Warner after that, but Warner really didn't know what to do with them. Not too long after that, they went into the Marine Corps, and when they came out, the Beatles were ascendant. So Kathy's Clown was their last number one hit, even though they had a couple of huge hits at Warner. George Avakian left Warner a little while after that. He went to RCA, and he reverted mainly back to jazz, and he became friends with a lot of the great jazz artists, including Miles Davis, Louis Armstrong, and Sonny Rollins. In many respects, he was as important as anyone at making jazz mainstream in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, but by the time he left RCA, jazz had lost its cachet to rock and roll, folk music, country music, R&B, and other genres. Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tapps. And I mentioned that one of the things that George Avakian did was he helped revive the career of Duke Ellington. And George Avakian did that with one legendary recording. In 1956, Duke Ellington's career was in decline. Many people were calling for him to retire. But he was scheduled to play at the 1956 Newport Jazz Festival, which was the festival for jazz aficionados. It was late, around midnight. Duke Ellington was tired. He wasn't in an especially good mood. But when he and his band went on, something electric happened. And there was an amazing energy that went through the crowd when he and his orchestra played his 1937 composition, Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue. That moment at the 1956 Newport Jazz Festival was one of the great moments in jazz history, and George Avakian was there to record it with different microphones, one for Columbia Records and the other for the Voice of America. And the thing that made it so memorable in Rebirth Duke Ellington was the sax solo by Paul Gonsalves in the middle, which is generally considered one of the greatest performances ever in jazz. It is so well known that several books have been written about that alone. So here's a little bit of the Paul Gonsalves solo recorded on the Voice of America microphone by George Avakian.
And now we would like to play some of our 1938 Diminuendo in Blue and Crescendo in Blue. These are separated by an interval by Paul Gonsalves.